Fresh start. It's a move in the right direction. I wish I had a believer up in here. When you call, by God, that's the qualifier.
Who's gonna learn from this? Who's gonna give
us some time to get the pride of life, the great I am. Somebody, anybody, can you give him a thank you praise?
For about 15 to 20 seconds, can we remind that joker and give him a spiritual headache?
And God is telling Jesus, get the hell out of you.
Can you look at somebody and say, I had to be stepped on. I had to be lied on. I had to be crushed. I wish I had some believers that would have church with me up in here. This.
Whew. What's up, y'all? Happy New Year's Eve or New Year's, whatever time that you're doing this. Welcome, 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 welcome. Can y'all see me? I can't see me. Welcome to Fresh Start Church. We exist to revive, refresh, release, and to restore people back to God. That is our mission, to make Jesus famous in your life. Hey, happy New Year's Eve, everybody. Happy New Year's Eve. I promise not to take too much of y'all time. I want you to keep celebrating with your loved ones, with your family, bringing in the new year just right, with all your New Year's resolutions, all that stuff, okay? Just bring it in nice. But I do want to give you a word before we jump over into the new year. Yeah, it's not going to be long. You know me. I ain't that long-winded. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to John chapter 6, okay? Don't be scared when I say this, okay? John chapter 6, verse 66. Cool? John chapter 6, verse 66. I will be reading from, I'm pretty sure it's the ESV. I'm pretty certain. No, it's actually a New King James Version this time. All right, so John chapter 6, verse 66, New King James Version. And it says, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. I don't have a title for this. I don't have a title for this at all. But if I were going to acquire a title for this specific word, it would be Everybody Can't Go. That's the title. Everybody can't go. Everybody cannot go. They just can't. So a little bit of backstory. At this point in time in Jesus' ministry, it is the beginning of the third year, his final year in ministry. Third year. And this is like the height of Jesus' popularity. It's like there are people following him from all over. Like, he's so popular. There are far more people who believe in Jesus than there are people who don't at this current point in time. And so he had already sent the disciples out to go make disciples, and they're on their way back. He fed 5,000. He then walked on water. Like, people are seeing the miracles, the signs, and the wonders of Jesus Christ. So it's hard to deny, you know, that he's this guy. He's just that guy. And so he's speaking in Capernaum, and when he's talking to all the people, he tells them that he is the bread of life, that he who eats of me, who drinks of my blood, I abide in him and he abides in me. This does not make people feel comfortable, because now Jesus is solidifying the fact that he is the Messiah and that he is God. So the people, they cool with Jesus healing people. They cool with him feeding 5,000. They are cool with seeing him walk on water. But the moment that he tells them that he is God, that I abide in you who drinks of my blood, who eats of my flesh, and you abide in me, the moment he begins to tell them who he actually is, it makes people uncomfortable. Like, people are cool with you while you're doing all the things that they need you to do for them. They're cool with you when they see how talented and how gifted you are. They are cool with you as long as they can benefit from you. But the moment they recognize, or you have them recognize, who you actually are, now we have a problem. It's all cool, it's all fun and games, until the moment you recognize the true power of who you are and you let people know that you recognize it. Now we got a problem. Like, these people are so uncomfortable right now. Like, they were just singing his praises. Like, there were thousands of people following Jesus. Jesus had far more than just 12 disciples throughout his 3 years of ministry. Far more than just 12. And they were all here, all the people that were following, thousands and thousands of people. And the moment he begins to say who he is God. He who eats of my flesh and drinks my blood, I abide in you, you abide in me. The moment he says that, now people have a problem with it. Now Jesus recognized something. Jesus recognized that it's not even about the number of people following him. It's just those who actually believe who are following him. So, like, social media, like, it makes sense how a lot of people could have 1.3 million, 5 million, 600,000 followers on their social media page, right? But then they speak, they post something, a reel, a story, or whatever, and it's not the same amount of people who are engaging with that content. Let's say someone has 500,000 followers and they post something, and now there's only a fraction of those people who are actually engaging with what they're saying, with what they're talking about. It's the same thing. These people were okay with following Jesus as long as they were in the crowd and didn't have to actually participate in what Jesus was doing. Now, Jesus says, I am God. I abide in you, you abide in me. Those who eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, those who abide by the commandments of the law that I am fulfilling, you my folk. Now that I have to participate in this thing that you're saying that you're doing, I don't want no parts of it. How many times you scroll through your social media, you'll see somebody's content, you'll look at it, you won't like it, you won't comment on it, you'll just keep on going because something about that content, you're like, I don't want no parts of that. This is what these people are doing with Jesus. They were fine following him until there was something required of them while they followed. Thankfully, Jesus is Jesus, and he doesn't change who he is to appease the comfort of other people, you know, like we do. Let's just be real. That's what we do a lot of times. And he doesn't appease anyone. He stands firm in who he is and what he's there to do, and he lets the chips fall where they may. At this point in time, the chips fell with most of the people who were following him, leaving him. We have tricked ourselves into believing that the name of the game is to get as many people as possible, to touch as many people as possible, to have as many people as possible follow us. That's what we've been taught. That's how we've been taught socially. That's how we've been taught economically. That's how we've been taught with church. Get as many people as we can. That is always our first go-to. But what if getting those people means sacrificing who you are and what you believe in to do it? How many of us have actually compromised who we are, what we do, and what we stand for the sake of getting more people? Getting more people involved, getting more people to participate, getting more people to follow. You know, God gave me one assignment this year, this first year of pastoring Fresh Start Church. He just gave me one assignment. He just said, hey, show my people freedom. That's all he wanted me to do. Show my people freedom. And I was on board. I was like, yeah, let's go do it. Let's show your people some freedom. I was on board with that part. I wasn't always on board with the method of how he wanted it done. Because I didn't understand. I'm like, God, like, how is this showing people freedom? It's just isolating. God, how is this showing people freedom when it's pushing people away? Like, how is this showing people freedom when you just want me to leave people alone? Like, the method in which he wanted to use to show people freedom, I was uncomfortable with because there was a huge part of me that still only just wanted to serve the people, how they felt, what they were doing, what made them feel good. But God was like, no, I need my people to know what actual freedom feels like. Freedom is the liberty of choice without obstruction, meaning nobody standing in your way. You can do what you do, live with those consequences, but you can do what you're going to do. Freedom. And that's what we did all year. With each series that we did throughout the year, it was exposing our freedom. Church is Dead. It exposed the separation between God's word and how we've treated it with the culture of church. Cuffing Season showed us our bondage with the way that we think about relationships. Let's Unpack That exposed our internal bondage that we have with ourselves and our past traumas. What Would Jesus Do showed us the life of Jesus as the word states it, rather than how we've treated it culturally and historically. Art of War equipped us to combat and to protect the freedom that we have. Because how many of us know that freedom ain't free? Bold AF showed us the crazy, the ambitious faith that we need to accomplish the things that God put inside of us. Due Season showed us that the freedom that we have does not come without work. Pray For Me enhanced our relationship and our communication with God. Launch Codes prepared us for the work we'd have to do once we get into the place that God was putting us in. Mandatory highlighted the necessity of our men leading from a proper place internally. And Running Away From Christmas, it highlighted, it exposed, and it sharpened the gifts that we're afraid that we have, that we're afraid to show everyone, that we're afraid to expose in ourselves. The things that we need to gain our freedom and to sustain our freedom. Those gifts. But one of the most uncomfortable things about freedom is that the same freedom that we have to walk forward into the things that we're called to is also the same freedom we have to walk away. And I remember when I first started as pastor of Fresh Start, and I remember like hearing people say and getting messages and overhearing people be like, yeah, like James is going to bring everything back, or we're going to get back to the fresh start that we know. And I would hear people talk about this, and in my head I was like, I don't think it's going to be like that. It's an uncomfortable feeling. It's because like you know what people want and what people love and what people are used to, what they're comfortable with. But then you also know that there's this space that they desire to be, that they're so afraid of going to, that this place that they're comfortable in, they'll stay there forever. And I was like stuck straddling the fence for a little while, because like on one side I was like, yeah, like I want this new thing that God is doing for our community and for his people. And at the same time, like I also like I want to be the one to bring this thing back to the thing that people were used to and comfortable with. But then God was like, you can't have both, bro. You either want what I have for you, or you want what I had for you. Wow. And so God is like, yo, if you do what I say, if you do what I'm telling you to do, you'll get what I have for you. If you do what you want to do, you'll get what you used to have. Granted, you might be happy with what you used to have. You may be happy with going back to how things were, but you will actually never know what I have for you until you move. Wow. We spent the entire year breaking free from the things that made us comfortable. We spent the entire year breaking free from the things that we didn't want in our lives anymore. We spent the entire year in destruction mode, in demo mode, eliminating everything that doesn't belong to us. And it hurt. It was uncomfortable. It broke bones. It broke spirits. It broke households. But it also cleared the way for whatever it is that God wants us to have and do. Yes, people walked away. God said, now I have more space. Yes, you didn't get that job that you thought would be your dream job. God's like, cool, bet. Now I have more space. No, the relationship didn't work the way you thought that it should work. God's like, cool, now I have more space. 2022 pretty much obliterated my life. God is like, straight. Now I have more space. God said, cool, now I got the space that I need in your life. In your life. I got the space that I need to work, to do my work. And bro, do you know what God does when he goes to work? He creates. He creates. God loves when there's nothing in his way. He loves when there's just space. He loves when things are empty so he can fill it by creating things for you. This is what we're going to be doing the entire year of 2023 and beyond. Okay, we have our freedom and it's been this empty space that now we have to fill it by creating the life that we were called to create in our own lives, in our own legacies, in our own families, in our own communities. We created the career that you want so badly and just so afraid to go after it. Well, there's nothing in your way anymore. There's nothing there. You gotta create it. Those relationships that you want to foster and cultivate and grow, you get to create it. There is so much empty space around you currently because God is preparing a place for you to create. Yo, God like, yeah, I tore that down so you can create this. Yes, I broke apart those relationships so you could create this. Yes, I made that not work for you so you could create this. This is going to be crazy. The thing that you've been asking God for as long as you can remember, for as long as you can remember, you get to create it now. You don't just get it bestowed upon you or gifted to you. Like now, you get to create it. The rules that you had to abide by before, they don't exist anymore. The statutes, the guidelines, the laws that you had to abide by, the rules that you had to walk on a thin line for at your job, whatever place you was working at, they don't exist. Think about the things that God has done when he's given the space to do it. Created the entire world in 6 days because nobody was in his way. Created Abraham thousands of generations because Abraham got out of God's way. Made David the greatest king we've ever known because he was a man after God's own heart, thus getting out of God's way. Save the entire world, giving salvation in a place that we can have relationship with him because Jesus got out of his way. When God said he'd create something new in you, he wasn't lying. And he's going to do that. As long as we get out of his way and let him do what he's doing so we can create the lives that we've desired for as long as we've desired them for. We love you. God loves you so much more. Happy New Year. Let's go create. We'll be right back.